Welcome to Sounds Like Spirit with Kim Melhot. Sound advice for spiritual souls for all your development and spiritual chat.
Guys in the chat room, we've got Fellini, Jody White Wolf, Tracy, Al, there's a whole heap of you in there. So thank you so much for your company today. I'd like to do a special shout out to Jody White Wolf for helping me out last week. We had issues with our technology, so her and I sat and chatted for an hour or so. It was fantastic. So I'd love to hear about all your Christmases. So if you can pop into the chat room at spiritualistsonline.com or get me a private message or however you want to contact me. There's just a wee note there in the chat room. Please, Colin, for the volume to go up a wee bit, please. So making sure we can all hear everybody, that's fantastic. Welcome along. So I just wanted to have a quick chat about Christmas because obviously horrendously topical right now. And I just, this year, Jody and I had a small chat about this last week, so I'm sorry if you're hearing some of this again, Jody, but I just wanted to have a chat about how much stress people create in their life over Christmas and how much of that stress that you create is unnecessary. Now, just to give you a couple of wee examples, in my life, for example, there's a distinct shortage of men around at the moment. I'm not complaining. You know, with men, I find there's a famine or a feast. It's a bit of a famine at the moment. But with my father and my uncle passing away, the patriarchs of the family, my brother more recently, and a lot of male acquaintances, but not a lot of really, really close male friends, there was no one available to put up the Christmas lights. And I realized about a week and a half before Christmas, of course, that this hadn't been done. Now, myself being not a big fan of ladders, I'm short, for those of you who aren't aware, I'm short. So climbing up ladders is not my favorite thing in the world. And the likelihood of reaching, say, for example, the top of the Christmas tree from the ground is just laughable. So sometimes you have to give a little in order to release a lot of that stress. So I gave up the Christmas lights, which is unfortunate because I do love to drive into my house at night and have it looking like, you know, a massive gingerbread house. But sometimes you just have to give a little on some of these things. Now, Christmas dinner was held at my place and I didn't know whether there'd just be two or three of my close family or if there would be a large amount of friends and family turn up. So I wanted to make sure I had enough food to have every eventuality covered. But I also wasn't going to go overboard. I had friends that said, oh, if I am coming to your place, I want the full and absolute Christmas dinner. We want the turkey and the potato bake and the everything like that. And I thought, well, actually, I'll do you a potato bake. That's handy and helpful, but there'll be no turkey. Yeah, because we decided we were going to barbecue and I didn't want all the stress and the effort of all that cooking. So I made a couple of favorite dishes belonging to favorite friends and family members. My daughter wanted a sweet chili beef that I do. So I did that. I did the potato bake for another friend. I had a vegetarian friend over from Australia, and the oven in her flat hasn't worked since she moved in, and I do a bite-sized roast veggies that she absolutely adores, and it's pretty basic. It's just potato and carrot and parsnip, and I cook it with either garlic or garlic oil and red onion, chunks of red onion just for flavor. Sometimes we have whatever's available, zucchini and capsicum quite often go in at the last minute there, or pumpkin, whatever's handy, but she loves that. So I thought, right, well, I'll make her that. So those were the only hot dishes we did. We got some lettuce from our own garden and made a wee salad. And dessert was just fruit. Most of it there for the look of it. I didn't even want to go to the effort of cutting it up. But we cut up bits of everything like nectarines and strawberries and apricots and stuff like that. And we had a bowl of icing sugar, a bowl of whipped cream, and a bowl of chocolate sauce. And I said, there you go, guys, go for it. So Christmas Day lunch was outside on the table with our feet in the grass. It wasn't a particularly warm day here. It was pleasant for the most of us, but I've got friends that feel the cold very strongly. So I wrapped them up outside in a wee blanket and a jacket, and the rest of us were wandering around in shirt sleeves, and it was a really, really good day. Yes, food talk, Jody. I'm sorry. Yes, it is. So it was an awesome day. And we had Christmas dinner outside, and there ended up being 8 or 9 or 10 of us. But so that's quite a few, considering I was only planning on 2 or 3. So a friend of mine pointed out to me just recently that the guest list that turned up sounded like the opening of a bad joke. It was hilarious when you think about it, because there was such a mix of cultures and religions and beliefs and non-beliefs and things like that. And it really is amazing to me that you can get a room full of people together like that for a day like Christmas. Of course, Hanukkah and Christmas were on the same day this year, I do believe, but I did put a wee note up on my personal page, and it said this: Merry Christmas. If I haven't managed to catch up with you or reply to you, I can only apologize. I wish you all a very Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, Happy Kwanzaa, season's greetings, Happy Holy Day, or ever offends you the least. And the reason I did that is because a lot of people will just put up one greeting, and I've noticed a few people get a bit titchy, and you know, it should be Happy Christmas, it should be Merry Christmas. Don't say that, say season's greetings. I'm thinking, well, I'm from New Zealand. I was raised in a Christian religion, well, many of them, to be fair, and it's always been Merry Christmas. So it'll remain Merry Christmas for me from now and, you know, to the day I die, I guess. But I just wanted to say, please don't be offended by other people's beliefs. It's huge that I point that out at this time of year. And it should be obvious. We're, anyone listening to the radio show at this point, for the most part, I'm assuming, is the spiritualists. And spiritualists believe that everybody is entitled to believe what they want to believe. But I have seen a lot of titching and moaning on Facebook about people coming down on other people for their beliefs. And I just want to say, you know, peace on earth, goodwill toward men, really, at this time of year. And I wanted to say that the lead up to Christmas has been awesome. Much making merry and connection with my friends, a few family members, a lot of soul family. I've had winter wonderland parties, steak nights out with friends, pre-Christmas dinners, Christmas get-together, drinks, barbecues, lunches at the mall, impromptu dance boogie nights, outdoor movies, friends gathering at home. And this is just the last 3 weeks, so it's been fabulous. And, of course, it culminated in the Kiwi Christmas barbecue lunch. And as I said, a friend of mine said it sounds like the beginning of a joke, because we had a medium, which was me, a Reiki master, a gay couple, 2 Jews, an atheist, and a Hindu Catholic. And it does so sound like the beginning of a really, really bad joke. But I was thrilled about it, absolutely thrilled, that you can get a few people from such vastly different cultures and vastly different races and vastly different religions together on a day like Christmas Day. So it was just fantastic, absolutely fantastic for me. That's right, lol. lol. It is hilarious, but it wasn't until she pointed it out to me that I realized that that was the case, because to me they were just my friends. And I've got one friend in particular, and she won't mind me talking about her, no names, but she is Indian, but she was raised in New Zealand as a Kiwi girl, and her father is Hindu, and her mother's Hindu, I think, and her father's Catholic. So raised as a real mix of cultures and religions all within the one person. So, yes, I've got Fellini in the chat room going, no kidding, should be shared and educated to know others' cultures, and frankly, many are not followers of their own faith as much. They mostly like some traditions that's family-oriented or food-oriented. Agreed. And I've got no objection to that. Fellini, even if it is a tradition that's family oriented or food oriented, if it still brings people together and shows to you the abundance in your own life, then that may well be the best part of their culture or their family. Yeah, absolutely, assembling. Now, one of the other things that I did want to mention about Christmas, I didn't actually spend Christmas with my family this year due to unfortunate and unforeseen circumstances. So, you know, Christmas and December could have been a really rotten month for me. And I'm looking back on it after I put that post up on the 25th and thought, actually, you know, It was a really, really awesome month. I've managed to catch up with almost everyone and I've had a great time. And these things that we did didn't cost money. I mean, we went to see Elf, which is the Christmas movie starring Will Ferrell. It's a kids' movie for the most part, but it was on an outdoor screen at the Cashel Restart Mall, which is the shopping centre that sprung up here in the centre of town as a sort of temporary replacement for the quake damaged centre that we lost. So it was very nice to sit there with a couple of hundred of your closest personal friends eating tiki tacos and watching a movie on the big screen while snuggled up in blankets and cushions. And I mean, these things are things that didn't cost money. I went to a wee place about 30 minutes outside of Christchurch called Kaituna Valley with a friend of mine. It's out Birdlings Flat Way. It's about half an hour from Christchurch City Central. And we went to the local church out there and we noticed straight away that it felt a little down. The church felt a little down. We could feel a lot of tears and crying. So we were assuming the last thing the church had been used for was a memorial service or a funeral. So me being me, just decided to sing a couple of quick hymns and carols, and we lightened the atmosphere of the church immediately and then just sat there and had a great talk, just sitting in the cool interior of this quiet country church. It felt very reverent and topical and appropriate, and it was just a fantastic thing to do. We had a quick walk around the local cemetery. I know some people find that morbid, but I actually find cemeteries very peaceful places. And then we had a lay down on the grass outside in the church grounds and did a quick meditation in the shade, because on that particular day it was 33 degrees. 33 degrees in New Zealand means you will burn within about 5 minutes or less. So you need to massively sunblock or find shade or a roof or something. So it was just an awesome day. And these are the sort of things that I'm talking about that we have been doing. I've gone out for meals with friends and we've had vouchers from a book you can get. You can get them nationwide here. I think you can get them in Australia. I'm not sure where else you can get them, but called the Entertainment Book. And they are vouchers for places where you can go and have like 2-for-1 meals. So for the price of one person, two of you can go and eat. So very cheap dates with girlfriends this month. And all these things have been done with friends and with a spirit of friendship and togetherness. So it's been fabulous to have that sort of camaraderie available to me for the whole of December and not just Christmas Day or the stress leading up to Christmas. And I had a lot of people say to me, you've got them there too, Jody, and their entertainment books. So they're fantastic because they give you discount vouchers for the areas that you're in. And if you really value yourself and you think yourself worthy and deserving, then you'll absolutely splash out to go and take yourself out for a meal or a 2-for-1 mini golf or whatever happens to be going on in your area. And finances don't have to be huge for you to do that. They just have to be, you know, you have to be a bit canny about how you go about these things or ask the universe to provide, but you can absolutely do it. But I just wanted to spend this first section of the show talking about how blessed I feel and how stressless my Christmas was. And I've got some owls coming in here going, would shut down. All right, okay. I thought you were saying calm, okay. People need to stress less around Christmas, you know, and sometimes you have to give a little. It's like buying a house, right? When you go to buy a house, you have a shopping list of what you want. You might want spacious linen closet. You might want an indoor access garage. You might want on a quiet street but close to a main thoroughfare. You might want to be close to shopping centres or schools. You might want to have a certain number of bedrooms or a certain size in your backyard and that sort of thing. And you want it to be in a certain area and you'd like it to be at under a certain price range. And anyone who's ever bought a house will know that when it comes to it, you're going to have to give up on some of those things because you can't. The biggest stopper there is usually price, right? Because that's where your limitation usually comes in for the most. So when you've got a limitation on price, you may have to give up the massive linen cupboards or a walk-in wardrobe or internal access garage. It might have to be one up the back. You might have to have a single garage instead of a double garage. But you'll get something that you will be more than happy to live in if you give up a few of those little things. And I feel that Christmas should be approached the same way. You have a shopping list in your head. And I mean, I'm not being sexist here, and I'm by no means excluding the men, but women will know what I'm talking about when I say you have a shopping list in your head. And I'm not talking for buying gifts for people. I'm talking about the things that you want to tick off on your Christmas list. Things like put the lights up, catch up with every family member, be the perfect hostess, or attend the perfect party, or some of those things. And sometimes, like with my Christmas lights, sometimes you just have to give up something on that list in order to get the maximum joy out of that day. You know, you're worthy and you're deserving. I'm worthy and deserving. And I don't want to get to that day. And this has happened with so many people I saw this year. They got to Christmas Day and they are so exhausted from the lead up to Christmas that they did not enjoy the time they managed to get together with family and friends. Now, I had a lot of people say to me in the 2 weeks or a week or 3 weeks out from Christmas, you know, how's your Christmas shopping going? Have you got everything sorted? And I said, nope. And they're horrified and their jaws drop and they're like, how are you going to manage? It's getting so busy. When are you going to do it? And I said, well, actually, I'm going to do it the day before Christmas. And they're going, are you crazy? And I'm going, no. And they're going, but why? And I said, well, look at you. No judgment, but look at you. You know, you're stressed out and you're tangled up in knots and you're tearing around like an idiot and you're just desperately trying to rush through all the stuff that you want to get done. You haven't taken any time for yourself. You haven't managed to enjoy what's been so far and you're just so stressed about everything. And I've had a fabulous 3 weeks. So I just want to say, if you can keep in mind for the next big occasion, even if it's a new year, let's say you have family get-togethers on New Year's Day or things like that, please cut the stress. And a huge part of this is attitude. You know, if you think it's going to be a problem and you think it's going to be stressful and you think you're not going to have enough time, then you're right. I think it was Henry Ford that said, if you think you can, you're right. If you think you can't, you're right. And that's exactly true, you know. And if you think it's going to be stress-free and easy and pleasant and a wonderful time, then it will be. And Fellini's just popped in the chat room and said, it used to stress me, but not anymore. I do what I can. And because they are older, I'm assuming you're talking about your children, it's so much easier. Just needs to be a thoughtful gift, and it satisfies me that I know them to know they will appreciate what I offer. That's right. So it's not about, and I really, really felt that this year. And I know my daughter and her friends are much older now too. They're just hitting sort of 25. And this was the first year I really, really noticed how non-commercial we are in our family when it comes to that sort of thing. My daughter brought me a present, and I'll tell you about it because it fascinates me endlessly. I love, I watch if anybody's friended me personally, you'll see on my timeline, every day in December, I watch a Christmas movie. And this year I decided to put it up online so that anybody else who wanted to join me for all or some of it could. So every day in December, I watch a Christmas movie. Now, this is a tradition that my daughter and I have done for years and years and years and years. And the first thing everybody says is, there aren't 25 Christmas movies. You bet there are. There are more than 25 blockbuster Christmas movies. But I enjoy them. And the message in all of them, of course, is be true to you, help others, goodwill toward men. So not a bad idea to wrap your head around that at this time of year. So we were watching a Christmas movie every day, and I was putting it up online so that other people could enjoy it. And one of my favorite Christmas movies is it's not exactly B grade, but it's certainly not an A grade movie from the 80s called Call Me Claus, and it stars Whoopi Goldberg. And the basic premise is about a woman whose father was fighting in Vietnam, and he was returned to him in the least pleasant way on Christmas 1 year, and ever since then she's lost the Christmas spirit. And it's about her finding her way back to that. But there's a song at the beginning called "Zat You Santa Claus," and we couldn't figure out. It took us ages to figure out what this song was. And going through the tiny wee scrolly bits on the credits, we discovered that it was an old Garth Brooks song. And you only hear a chorus and a verse of it in the background in the movie, but it's fantastic. It's got a swing kind of a sound to it. And it's completely, totally not Garth Brooks. And my daughter and I have been trying to find this song for quite some time because we've been wandering around singing it for years, but only the bit we know because it's the only bit we've heard. And Garth Brooks never put his music online, so we weren't able to get buy a copy of it online or download it or any of those things. And he's also, Lord love him, not one that believes that musicians should make money off their ego by re-releasing hits that they've had in the past or by playing on people's emotions by releasing re-releasing Christmas music or celebratory music and that sort of thing. So in the end, she managed to get me this CD for Christmas. That was my present, and I was so surprised to see it. I think we're down here in little old New Zealand, quite well away from the rest of the world, and she managed to find one of only four copies secondhand online through someone in the States and managed to get that over for me. Now, as Christmas gifts go, it wasn't very costly, but I know what a fantastic effort she put into that and how much it means to me to have that. It's a whole album of songs, but really the only one that we were fascinated in was the 2 minutes and 32 worth of "Zat You Santa Claus." So, and that's the sort of gift I'm talking about when we're talking about don't stress about buying the biggest and best and brightest of things for people, because those aren't the gifts that mean anything. And I the one thing I had to give up this year, the one thing I missed out on, was the little children. And I love the little children, you know, at Christmas, because they're just so excited and it's such a fabulous time and they're so thrilled to have everybody together and they bounce around the place like little Energizer bunnies and it's just fabulous. But I did miss out on that this year. But that aside, it was nice to have a very non-commercial Christmas with my close family and friends this year. So I'm just going to have a quick pop through the chat room and pick up. So, yes, Jody's saying she likes to give Christmas presents all year instead of on just one day. That's fantastic, Jody. Very merry un-Christmas to you. I can hear you singing that. That's off the Alice in Wonderland, isn't it? A very merry un-birthday. Every day that's not your birthday is an un-birthday. Fellini's bought presents like a quartz, a Louise Hay book about loving self, abalone shell. Abalone, in New Zealand we call that paua, P-A-U-A, paua, for burning leaves and a few other stones and a cup skull design, his type of stuff. That's lovely. So that's fantastic. And that's the sort of thing I'm talking about. I had a friend give me a rose quartz chunk of stone that can be hung like in a car or off a light in the center of a room or things like that. And it's just, it's fantastic. But, you know, particularly with the kids, they don't remember. They're not going to remember what you gave them for Christmas on their 7th birthday or their 11th birthday or their 9th Christmas or their 4th Christmas. They really don't. But they will remember the love and support that you provide when every time they say, hey, look at this, that you're there to turn around and do exactly that. So I just want to say, just in a quick recap, because I'm being told it's time for a break, a quick recap, is that please try and de-stress on the big occasions, not just Christmas, but whatever it is that you celebrate in your family and birthdays, a new year, Thanksgiving, if you're in the States, all those sorts of things. Please try and make it a little stress less with the upcoming celebrations. You don't need to go overboard, you know. Kiwis are huge on potluck, which is, hi, everyone, turn up at my place 12 o'clock on Saturday and bring whatever you feel like bringing, you know. And it's far better than one person or two people carrying the burden of trying to feed 20 people or wash plates. You know, seriously, this year I think I spent $4 on eco-friendly paper plates and eco-friendly wooden was good on me, knives and forks. I think it cost me $4. So to feed on and off over 3 days, about 20 of us. There were no dishes. It all went in the recycling bin. You know, the excess food and scraps and the plates and the knives and forks all go in the recycling bin. No cleanup, no serious cooking involved. I did three hot dishes and everybody else bought whatever they wanted. And it was just, you know, yeah, I can see Fellini saying tempers were close to blowing at your brother. I didn't have those issues this year because I didn't spend it with my family. And I, you know, yeah, I think we'll get into that after the break, because familial issues are a whole nother ball game on the Christmas stress party. So I'm just going to take a short break, guys. You are listening to me, Kim Malhop from Sounds Like Spirit. We're live on SOC Radio with the Sound Advice for Spiritual Souls. If you're just joining us, welcome, welcome. I know I talk a lot to the lovely people in the chat room because they're interacting with me. But I'd like to thank you all so much, those that are listening on tunein.com or spiritualistsonline.com from everywhere in the world. It'll be nice if someone can get me that information. I always like to know who's listening and from what countries. It always fascinates me. And we're going to pop off for a short break now of a couple of minutes. I'll still be talking in the chat room, and we'll pop back to this topic very, very soon.
We will be back shortly with Kim on Sounds Like Spirit. Spirit Talk with Julie. Spirit's medium, Julie Simpson, and guests delve into the world of spirit, the faith and the way of life, renewing the movement that brought two worlds together and ancient spiritual beliefs to the forefront of society, proving once and for all there is nothing to fear in talking to spirit. Live in the SOC Radio chat room on spiritualistsonline.com, or simply listen in at tunein.com and search for SOC Radio. Beyond the Veil with Terry Oz. Check it out first Monday, monthly, 2 p.m. UK time. Terry shares her experiences and love of spiritual communication with those from beyond the veil. Join us live in the SOC Radio chat room on spiritualistonline.com, or simply listen in at tunein.com and search for SOC Radio. Jenny Lee brings you spiritual insights, covering various topics from remote viewing to her upcoming book launch. Check it all out on our schedule live in the SOC Radio chat room on spiritualistsonline.com, or simply listen in at tunein.com and search for SOC Radio. Thoughts through critical thinking with your host Shane, a weekly show challenging all to take a breath. Through critical thinking, we explore thoughts each Wednesday at 10 p.m. UK time, Thursday 11 a.m. New Zealand time, live in the SOC Radio chat room on spiritualistsonline.com, or simply listen in at tunein.com and search for SOC Radio. Spiritualistsonline.com, online since 2002, teaching all aspects of personal and spiritual development. Free to all with audio video chat rooms, members forums, and SOC Radio live shows on site. The Spiritualists Online Network and Lyceum, a global oasis for spiritual awareness, development, attainment, imparting knowledge, thoughts, ideas to inspire. One site, linking a whole network of spiritually informative, educational, and interactive services, encompassing every faith, path, walk, religion as one. Sounds Like Spirit with Kim Melholt. Sound advice for spiritual souls. For all your development and spiritual chat, join Kim weekly at 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. Wednesdays, New Zealand time, 9 p.m. Tuesdays, UK time, live in the SOC Radio chat room on spiritualistsonline.com, or simply tune in at tunein.com and search for SOC Radio. Welcome back to Sounds Like Spirit, sound advice for spiritual souls.
Hi guys, welcome back. You're talking with me, Kim Malhop, Sounds Like Spirit, on the Sound Advice for Spiritual Souls show. You are listening live on SOC Radio. For those of you who are listening in and haven't participated in the show before, you can jump into the SOC chat room. You can log in as a guest, or you can log in under a name that you can set up, and then you can interact with me in the chat room. We're just having a quick talk in the chat room, and I'm just going to quickly catch up on some of the chatting here. Jody says, then folks say, what if we all bring dessert? And you say, great, that's right. Fellini's going, her cream caramel collapsed. I bet you it was eaten anyway, Fellini. That's the sort of thing I'm talking about when I'm saying less stress at Christmas. nice job. Fellini did a Russian salad as always. We wolfed it down 3 days. The flan, OMG, what a disaster. even forgot to put in the vanilla. There you go. Look, there we go, by the way. Lovely. Jodie Whitewolf saying she's a guest this week on her show on Spirit Weavers will be Blue Sphere. How exciting. Dimitri's just joined us. Welcome along, Dimitri. We're just talking about making Christmas with less stress. So the quicker things are, don't go berserk on spending. No one should put themselves into debt trying to prove to somebody that they love them. Because if you have to prove it by buying a bigger, better present, then I'm thinking the love is not real, people. So please don't put yourself into debt trying to show somebody that you love them at Christmas time. If people know you, they'll understand your circumstances. Some of the best gifts that I've received this Christmas, and there hasn't been, you know, we're not a big family and not huge, but are the ones that have huge meaning to me, as we talked about earlier, like I got a rose quartz crystal, that's fantastic. My daughter bought me a song, which is very minimal in the cost stakes, but huge in the effort stakes, and it shows massive amounts of love. So I'm thrilled about that. And, you know, just don't go overboard. Not, and this is not just for Christmas. I'm putting this out there for all celebrations, you know, Thanksgiving or New Year's or birthdays or anything that's coming up. Please do not go overboard. Do not put yourself into debt to try and prove to somebody that you love them. That's not how it works, all right? Not how it works. So don't put yourself into debt. That's the first thing. The next thing is let it go. If you can't get up the ladder to put up those lights, just leave them this year. You know, if you can't get to family or due to whatever sort of unforeseen circumstances have occurred, your family can't get together for Christmas, have a look at what you can do and who you can spend time with. You know, don't go berserk on these things because it creates a whole heap of stress. Don't give yourself this massive list of things that you think you need to achieve to make it a successful Christmas. You can have a successful Christmas or a successful celebration with nothing, you know? You can have it with nothing. As I pointed out earlier, all the things that I did this month were free of cost, absolutely free of cost. They cost nothing to go to, nothing to get into. They were cheap to free on almost everything that I did this month, and they were all hugely enjoyable. They were all done with friends or close family, and they were fantastic. So don't go overboard on thinking it has to be this big deal of who you have to see and what you have to do and how much you have to buy, because it's just not like that. That's not how you get the best out of Christmas. That's it's not how you get the best out of any situation. I see Tracy here has put gift vouchers and cards you usually get. And some people, that's excellent. Some people think that is a bit of a cop-out, but I actually think it's excellent because people can go and choose. Maybe there's something, like my daughter, for example, I know she's an absolute stationery nut, and I know where she gets that. Sorry, honey. Comes from me. Someone likes shoes. We love stationery. So I could get her a gift voucher to any stationery store anywhere, bloody Smiggle or Kiki K or any of those, and she'd be thrilled. Jodie's got here, a favourite gift to give used to be a coupon book with vouchers for things you'll do for a person during the year, i.e. do your dishes three times to market. Now, isn't that funny, Jodie, because I had a nephew that used to do that, and he used to give things to my sister, his mother, on things like Mother's Day, and it'll be a voucher for a free breakfast and a massage and a this and a that, and we'd have a whole heap of things. And there'd be tiny little fine print at the bottom, and it would say valid only till 6 a.m. on the day of the voucher. So that was his wee joke. He thought he was funny. So she wouldn't get it until after the voucher had expired. But yeah, and Dimitri's coming saying, yes, good advice. Love is being with someone and your friends. Better to spend time with them for 365 days a year. That's exactly right. That's what I was saying, Dimitri. You know, December and Christmas could have been a miserable month for me. We had to pass one of the furry family members over this year, and I've missed her dreadfully, and particularly at Christmas, because she used to hide, that's a euphemism because she was never hidden, and she knew that, and we knew that, behind the Christmas tree. This is my cat, Zinny, and we had to pass her over this year. She got in a horrible accident, unfortunately, and I thought about putting up the Christmas tree, and the first thing I thought about was her, and we were organising for family for Christmas Day, and my brother passed away unexpectedly sort of about 6 weeks ago, and, you know, my father's no longer here, or his older brother, so all the family patriarchs are gone. It could have been a really, really miserable December. And when I put the post up in December and I counted back all those things that I'd done, a nightly Christmas movie with my daughter and the open-air movies and the going to the church with a friend and out for a quick mall lunch with a catch up with a couple of others and a Christmas barbecue, I thought it's actually been a pretty awesome month, you know, pretty awesome month. Now, what we touched on just before the break was issues with family. And if I can find what I'm looking for, and I can't. Okay. What I was looking for was some information a friend of mine had posted online about a week or so ago. Jacqueline Fairbrass from Bramble Cottage, if anybody wants to look it up. She did a post on Christmas and de-stressing, and it just resonated so strongly with me. And one of the huge things she talks about was family. And I want to put this in here for you guys and everybody listening to understand that family are important, but it's not always hearts and flowers when it comes to family, you know. Sometimes we have expectations that aren't met. That's what I want to say. Okay, and I've just found it. She's got a post called Holiday Expectations Be Gone. And I just want to find the section she wrote about family. Okay. So she says, as a kid, I had a wonderfully naive belief on Christmas Day, a sort of, for one day only, there was no crime or hate or cruelty on the planet. I believe the actual belief initially came from hearing about ceasefires in the First and Second World Wars. I then added my family's own ceasefire. My parents would do their best not to argue and relatives would be civil at the family gatherings. And as my family of origin is highly emotive and flamboyant, I love that phrase, highly emotive and flamboyant, because I know that's going to cover a multitude of sins. This sense of civility was an unusual blessing. Truly a ceasefire sums it up nicely. And I believed, she continued, that the world was a wonderfully safe place on Christmas Day. And I remember this belief being totally destroyed one Christmas when I heard of a violent crime being committed by a shop Santa. Yet still there persists within me a sense of it should be safe on Christmas. Now that's huge, but right, here we go. A section on family. So Jacqueline carries on to say, think about this. How peaceful and loving is your family gathering? It can be an awful lot of pressure to put a group of people into a room or a home, people who don't usually get together, but feel, because it's the holidays, that they should. Really dislike that word, should. It implies obligation, doesn't it? What if instead of expecting people to behave in certain ways, we allow them to simply be who they truly are? And that includes ourselves. And if the bottom line is you don't really want to be with these people, then go and be with some people you want to be with instead, or spend some time with yourself. Allow you to do what you want to do and be with the people who you really do care about. Now, this is huge. It's one very, very small paragraph, but it's huge. It's massive. And Dimitri's put an excellent thing up on the chat room here. Find a way to bring them with you into your life with no physical contact. We don't choose family, Fellini says. We're bound together to learn about each other and ourselves. But yeah, you're right. We don't always choose in this physical life. We've chosen in our soul pod before we come here. And that's right. But the point that Jacqueline makes is completely and absolutely valid. You know, I personally had a fantastic childhood. You know, people always ask you that. Anytime you've got an issue in your adult life, they go, and how was your childhood? Were you beaten as a child? Are you sexually abused? Yes, I've been beaten and abused, but it wasn't in my childhood and it wasn't by my family. So I've had a wonderful childhood and a fantastic upbringing. But there are four children in my family, and So that's six of us all up, and we are as different as you could possibly be. There is not really one of us. Probably my brother who passed and I were probably closer in attitude than anyone else. Not outwardly. Outwardly, he was very, very quiet and reserved. And outwardly, I'm clearly, as you can tell, so not. So, you know, we're so very, very different people, and we have very, very different yardsticks for measuring the success of our lives and our attitudes towards people and things like that. And I love my family dearly, but I don't always like what they do. In fact, I often very much don't. I don't use the word hate, you know, and I don't hate people, but I can hate what they do. And but there's not a lot you can do about some of those things sometimes. Jodie's popped up with a crock of shoulds. That's exactly right. The word should needs to be removed from your vocabulary. Seriously, if you want to love and value and be worthy and deserving, which you are, you need to stop using the word should. Or I really should go and see so-and-so. Should you? If you want to, I really want to go and see so-and-so. That's got a hugely different energetic connotation to it than I should. If you think you should go and see someone or you should spend time with someone, then it's an obligation, and find another way to pass off that obligation. You know, maybe what you want to do is a phone call on the day. So you have your family Christmas, you have your Christmas day with the soul family, the people you want to spend time with, and you make a phone call to the family members that, you know, you can't spend time with or don't want to spend time with, you know. Jodie's saying should and try both be gone. You are absolutely correct, my love. So you need to make sure that you're not just spending time with people out of obligation, because that is no way to live, you know. If that's why you're spending time with family, because you're obliged to, then maybe you need to rethink the priorities in your life, because you should be your first priority. And if you have to walk on eggshells or be told, oh, just be careful what you say around so-and-so, we don't want them upset, then those people aren't calling you in for the good of you. They're calling them in for the good of themselves. And that's no way to live, you know. So I just quickly recap. Decorating's fantastic. If it brings you joy, do it. If it's tedious and it drags you down, don't bother. Same with cooking. If you love to do it, cook up a storm. If you love to entertain, throw the best parties. But if you don't, then accept invitations to other parties and take a fabulous hostess gift, you know, exchange complete. You don't have to, you know, forget about all the traditions. You know, I don't have to cook a turkey. New Zealand isn't big on turkey anyway. We're kind of chicken and duck people here. But even if we were, I wouldn't do it. It's too much time and too much effort. Where do you store it? How long does it take to cook? You know, it's a drama. We're a country of barbecues and backyards, so, and beaches, a picnic at the beach. I've had a couple of Christmases at the beach, and they've been fabulous. We've just all taken club sandwiches or sliced ham or, you know, dips and breads and what have you, and gone berserk down at the beach for the day. So don't worry about, you know, and this being stressed out by traditions. You know, as I pointed out earlier, what did we have? A medium, a Reiki master, two Jews, a gay couple, an atheist and a Hindu / Catholic. You know, they're not going to care that all their particular traditions weren't met. They were all just happy to be spending the day with people that they enjoy spending time with and being, you know, well-fed and well-entertained. And you know, so don't worry about hurting the feelings of others. Do what you want to do. That's the important thing. Now, I want to pop back into Jackie's thing very, very quickly, because she said about family. So often when we worry about hurting the feelings of others, we're just projecting our own fears on them. For example, 2 years ago, my husband and I chose not to go to his mother's family for Christmas. We had our reasons and let the family know. After the initial shock, it turned out that his mum used the opportunity to do what she really wanted to do. She went off to a coastal hotel with her husband for a few days. It turned out that she felt that if she stopped doing Christmas dinner, everyone would be upset with her. But after all the years of being the entertainer, she really wanted a quiet Christmas with her husband and someone else doing all the cooking. My sister-in-law then headed south for a vacation with her husband a day early. Everyone was happy. Check your traditions and ask yourself, is it a tradition? Does it serve you? Or is it just a bad habit? That's what I want to know. So I am toying with the idea of flapping off to Fiji next year with my daughter just to see. It's not that we didn't enjoy Christmas this year. We did. We had an absolute ball. But I am saying, please don't put yourself under stress and strain and misery for somebody else's idea of a good time. Ours coming back with turkey is kind of tasteless and boring. I'm loving the food theme that's coming through here because it's fabulous. Okay, Jody's saying she drowns yours in thick gravy. Well, that's great. You know, see, we eat chicken here and it's nice and moist. Now, funnily enough, if you told me, I'm not vegetarian, but if I had to kill it myself, I probably would be. Tracy's chimed in with we have pork and turkey and lamb. Dimitri, I had salmon, very yummy, ham at home. So you can see, even with a cross section of people in the chat room today, no one said, right, well, you must have turkey and you must have this and you must have that. And Dimitri's chimed in with don't go out. Don't cook, go out. And I had a friend here last night who did exactly that. Her and her husband went to a restaurant and they had a ball. No cleaning up, no mess. I had another friend here up from Ashburton last night and he said the same thing. They went to Christmas at his brother's and dinner at the sister-in-law's or something like that. So for the first time in years, and when I'm saying years, I'm talking years. Often these stupid traditions go on for 20 years or 30 years or 40 years. And if they serve you well, that is fantastic. But if they do not serve you well, please rethink them. For goodness sake. And I can't say it enough because the people that I've talked to that have been stressed out this month have been people that have been working off the should. Their list and the shoulds. I should get this done. I should visit so and so. And I've got to make sure I do this. And in all that, I hardly ever hear anyone say, I want to visit so and so. I want to make time for this or for me. Instead, they're stressing. Jody's coming with, I want a permanent invite to Fellini's and Tracy's for dinner once a week. Excellent. I love it when we all connect, especially like this. And it thrills me endlessly. And I've said it before, and you'll hear me say it a million times. No exaggeration. It will be said a million times. It fascinates me endlessly that we can do this, that we can be talking and chatting and texting and listening in almost every country in the world, from every religion, from every type of home, from every race and culture. We can all get together in a place like the chat room here or online and converse and entertain and create friendships. It's fantastic. So yeah, you guys in the chat room or anyone listening in, if you want to hook up with someone else who's in here, absolutely go ahead and do it. Because the more we connect, the better. And I don't want to get political here, but I just want to say about war very, very quickly. No war has ever been stopped with hate. Okay? No war has ever been stopped with hate. You heal with love, and you can't heal a whole country at once, but you can heal yourself, and you can heal the person next to you, and you can help out your neighbor. And when they're in a position to do so, they'll pass that on. And I guess it's a form of pay it forward, but if you can do that, and the people that you help do that, that's how you end the world wars. That's how you end the hate. You know, one person at a time. And this Christmas stress is a perfect example of this. People go, don't be ridiculous, Kim. How can you make a jump from Christmas stress to war? Easy. Easy. People who haven't queued for 2 hours waiting for something in a shop or, are ready to blow their brains out over the stress that the Christmas has created or the massive feeling of letdown they get when they look at their credit card and they've got this huge debt. You know, that makes for some very angry, very upset people. So start with de-stressing the day-to-day stuff in your life, especially on these big occasions. Tracy's laughing. Yes, apparently next year there's going to be a huge gathering at Christmas. Now, isn't it funny? Because that's what happens at my place. Every year for the last 3 years, I expected there to be my daughter, myself, and maybe my daughter's boyfriend. And every year for the last 3 years, even though it hasn't been family oriented, like blood relative family oriented, I've ended up with a massive group of people that have had a ball. So Demetra's saying she'll get 2 Christmases because she gets to go and see family and friends for as long as you need to spend time with them. So that's fantastic. That's fantastic. And Alice chimed in with, it's true, we pile ourselves up with chores and totally destroy Christmas. So this is exactly what I've been trying to get through to you so far today. Not just Christmas, but every occasion. And let's step back from that once again. And not just every occasion, but every day. So if you bring this back to your day-to-day life, what is it that you do? Feel free to help out here in the chat room, guys. What is it that you do on a daily basis that causes you a lot of stress that you do not need to do, that you do not need to stress over, that you don't need to worry about? What is it that you do on a daily basis? I've got friends that do some things that I think are irrelevant. I've got one who irons her washing. I'm just letting that sink in for a minute for those of you who understand my point of view. She irons her washing. No judgment. If that's what you want to do, that's what you want to do. But from my point of view, that would be hugely stressful and a massive waste of time. Everything, underwear, tea towels, sheets and pillowcases. I'm a big fan of folding it up and putting it on the bottom of the pile. That way you've got first in, first out stock rotation. Comes from working in food service, that does, for years. Stock rotation, and the ones on the bottom will be self-pressed by the ones sitting on the top. So it would stress me out if I forced myself to have to do that every day, so I don't. So what is it that you have in your life that you could flick off and be far happier without? What is it that you have that you could flick off and be far happier without? Okay, we're having a quick look through on the chat room. Tracy was saying she's at brother's wife's house and they love to cook because he's a chef. Okay, so if that's what I said. If you love to cook, go ahead and cook. Dimitri's been saying, she's been saying it for 40 years. If you live it, you'll make it wonderful. Love self and then show people how you care when they see that your way is better. It's not about forcing your way of life on anybody, though. I just want to make that really, really clear. It's not about saying, because once again, that's a judgment. It's not about saying, this is fantastic. You know, you need to do it my way. It's this is how it works for me. Feel free to take that on board. So don't stress about those things on any occasion. And I want, as I said, I want to bring this back to your day-to-day life. What is it you are doing? I want you all to have a think about this. What is it you do on a day-to-day life that you could let go? That's a job that maybe really truly belongs to somebody else and you could delegate it back to those people. What is it you do that stresses you out? Perhaps if you pop it down here, you see somebody else might have an alternative way of doing things. So that might be the way to look at it. So if you've got a problem, put it out there and see if other people have alternative ways of doing it. And I know this is an area in which Facebook is fantastic. The Book of Faces, as it's called in our house. The Book of Faces. If you've got a problem, you can put it out there. And find out from other people how they handle it, how they manage it. And, you know, two heads are better than one and four heads are better than two. And Jody's saying, would someone like to come and use your dishes? Lol, 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 lol. Isn't it funny? For the first time in years, I'm considering getting a dishwasher, Jody. You would think it would make more sense to have a dishwasher when you have a ton of people at home and all those dishes to do, but it's actually the other way around. I feel it's kind of pointless doing dishes when you've only used utensils and cutlery and things like that for one or two people. It seems like a dreadful waste of water and resources, but I don't like leaving them sitting on the bench. I am now, after all these years of having a billion dishes to do, toying with the idea of getting a dishwasher. But yeah, it's those sorts of things. What ways can you make this easier for yourself? You know, as I said, for Christmas dinner, I bought eco-friendly paper plates and wooden knives and forks, and they were cheap. They were cheap as, I think it cost me $4. It was very, very little. You could probably use that on a day-to-day basis, and then when you're finished eating off them, you can just biff them in the bin because they're recyclable. So yeah, there are ways of getting around those dishes, Jody. There are ways of getting around those dishes. Cooking in edible dishes, that's something my daughter used to do. If she was making dessert, she'd make a chocolate cup and put the dessert in that. So you'd eat the tray, you'd eat the plate. Same with things like taco salads. You can put them in tortillas or things like that that you can shape into a bowl shape. So you eat the salad and eat the bowl. So there are ways of avoiding even dishes, Jodie, my love. So, okay, what else have we got coming up there on the chair? Okay, Dimitri's saying she now only dusts once in a while because dust used to drive her to distraction. Then a very good friend told me that dust is thick today and tomorrow you get the same amount of dust, but it pushes the dust down so it's still this thick. Okay, that's right. So you don't need to do it daily or you're just going to let it replace itself. So to a point, that's right. Obviously, if you have allergies to dust or something like that, you might want to consider doing it on a more regular basis. But that's exactly right. You know, as long as you do sort of a thorough clean out periodically, I don't think you need to do that daily. And once again, I do have friends who do that daily, who get all carried away and dust every nook and cranny. And I'm not sure how they find the time because I don't have it. And if I did, I would probably prefer to go for a walk on the beach or catch up with a friend or rather than sitting at home and making sure every corner is clear. Now, this is exactly what I'm talking about. Now, it's fantastic that you guys have come through on the chat room on this for me. It's fantastic to say that if somebody's got a problem, somebody else can come through and say how they do it, how they make it less stressful for themselves. I'm just having a quick look. Why make the bed when you're just going to rumple it that night? That's funny, Jodie. Although with me, and here again, no judgment. With me, my brain feels cluttered if I don't make my bed. It's the one thing I have to do. And everybody has those things. But, you know, if there's a better way of doing it. And my better way of doing it, Jodie, making the bed, is I don't actually tend to have sheets. I have a bottom sheet, which is a fitted sheet, so it stays on and in place nicely. And I have a continental blanket on the top. And a duvet or a quilt cover on top of that. So it's very, very simple to make my bed. It's just a question of pulling everything up and straightening it out. It's very, very quick. I don't have to worry about hospital corners and, you know, hours spent going around both sides of the bed to straighten everything up. So there are ways of making everything in your life easier, right down to these teeny, tiny, little things. So, and that's... Dimitri's saying she saw plates made of leaves on Facebook. That's exactly right. If you're in tropical countries... when I was in just a wee bit further north in the South Pacific, they tend to eat a lot of banana leaves and things like that. So very eco-friendly. Jodie's popped in with how perfect can we do what doesn't stress us. That's exactly right. So I know we started talking about Christmas holidays and the stress that comes in with familial issues and our expectations shopping list. And what we've done now is we've brought it back to what do you do on a day-to-day basis that you could make quicker or more efficient or less stressful to give yourself a better shot at a calm and stress-free day. Okay, I think we're due for a break. Is that right, Colin? I don't want to pop off until I hear from him to make sure he's ready and good to go.
Indeed. Vacuum.
Excellent. Valeni's just popped in with vacuuming is sort of fun now. Mine wasn't working till I sanded the metal connection point. Man, it's satisfying to vacuum. Now, we all have that too. I love to mow a lawn. I think a house looks messy, like a person that's got hair with split ends or, you know, straggly or something like that. And I think, you know, when you mow a lawn, everything just looks so perfect and neat and tidy. So everybody has things that they do enjoy doing. And those things that bring you joy absolutely are not creating stress. But those things that you do that are not bringing you joy, those are the things we want to look at changing or finding a less stressful way of dealing. So I'm going to leave this topic here at the moment. We're going to take a short break and we'll be back soon. My name is Kim Melhot from Sounds Like Spirit. You are listening live on SOC Radio to Sound Advice for Spiritual Souls, and we'll be back with a new topic, I feel, after this short break.
We will be back shortly with Kim on Sounds Like Spirit. Beyond the Veil with Terry Oz. Check it out first Monday, monthly, 2 p.m. UK time. Terry shares her experiences and love of spiritual communication with those from beyond the veil. Join us live in the SOC Radio chat room on spiritualistonline.com or simply listen in at tunein.com and search for SOC Radio. The Circle of Mediums Radio Show. 6 mediums, healers, psychics, tarot, astrologers, spiritual workers every week, sharing spirit messages, development techniques, guidance and much more. Live in the SOC radio chat room on spiritualistonline.com or simply listen in at tunein.com. Search SOC radio. Would you like to contribute readings, thoughts, teachings and time to this two-hour show? Get in touch at socradioshows@gmail.com. Jenny Lee brings you spiritual insights, covering various topics from remote viewing to her upcoming book launch. Check it all out on our schedule live in the SOC radio chat room on spiritualistonline.com or simply listen in at tunein.com and search for SOC radio. Spirit Weavers with Jody White Wolf Morrison, a weekly one-hour radio show, Thursdays 8 p.m. UK time, featuring those who are dedicated to living their spirituality and exploring how that is woven into their everyday lives through their work, practices and beliefs. Various SOC members from Spiritualist Online Network and Lyceum sharing their abilities, knowledge and more. Dates and times will vary. Live in the SOC radio chat room on spiritualistonline.com or simply listen in at tunein.com and search for SOC radio. Thoughts through critical thinking with your host Shane, a weekly show challenging all to take a breath. Through critical thinking, we explore thoughts each Wednesday at 10 p.m. UK time, Thursday 11 a.m. New Zealand time, live in the SOC radio chat room on spiritualistonline.com or simply listen in at tunein.com and search for SOC radio. Sounds Like Spirit with Kim Melholt. Sound advice for spiritual souls. For all your development and spiritual chat, join Kim weekly at 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. Wednesdays, New Zealand time, 9 p.m. Tuesdays, UK time, live in the SOC radio chat room on spiritualistonline.com or simply tune in at tunein.com and search for SOC radio. Welcome back to Sounds Like Spirit, sound advice for spiritual souls. We will be back shortly with Kim and Sounds Like Spirit.
Video to me, Kim Melhop, Sounds Like Spirit and the Sound Advice for Spiritual Souls show. Welcome along, everyone listening out on the airwaves. It would be fantastic to hear who's listening and from what country. So if anybody can get that information to me, that would be fantastic. Welcome to all in the chat room. We've been having a very lively discussion today on Christmas. It's really, really got people going. I've done an hour on Christmas now, so I'm going to let that go. But just to quickly reiterate, de-stress yourself. Don't do things that you think you're obliged to do that are done just because it's a bad habit, a long-standing habit, someone else's tradition or someone else's expectation. If that's the case, give it up. You don't need it in your life. All right, what have we got? In the chat room, we're going, weeding the garden used to be it for Judy. Judy, that's exactly right. A lot of these things that people find pleasant to do, like lawn mowing and weeding the gardens, are very therapeutic. They're a form of meditation, which makes them less of a chore and much more of spiritual development. Now, speaking of spiritual development, woohoo, what a lovely segue we've got there. I'm going to talk about clear senses. I popped this up on my site about 3 months ago, and I repeated it yesterday. So if any of you need to see it, it's on the Sounds Like Spirit group, not the Sounds Like Spirit page, the Sounds Like Spirit group. It's under Tuesday New Zealand, Tuesday's topic of Tools of the Trade, and it's Clear Senses Gifts. So it keeps coming up. So here's the refresher, and here's my belief, take it or leave it. Certain people aren't given certain gifts. You all have all of them. Cool, huh? This comes up all the time. How do I know what gifts I have? Easy, because the answer to that is all of them. People say that to me all the time. Will my spiritual gifts grow? Will I be able to develop them? Answer's easy. Yes. Do I have gifts? The answer's easy. Yes. How do I know what I have? Well, that's easy. All of them. I can't reiterate this often enough. I get people ask me all the time. you know, where how can I develop this gift, or I just don't have that gift, and I just metaphorically, of course, would like to slap them every time I hear that. I don't have the gift. Of course you do. Of course you do. You all have all of them. Everyone is born with a basic toolkit, the basic soul kit, if you will. Clairvoyance, clairsentience, clairaudience, and claircognizance. These are the abilities to see, intuit, hear, and know. For those that are you're a bit more new age, clairsentience has a couple of subgroups. Clairsentiency, which is the ability to smell, the ability to taste, which is clairtangency, the ability to feel. But they're all a form of feeling using your senses. So there are subsections to that clairsentience. But clairvoyance, clairsentience, clairaudience, and claircognizance. I've just been told I'm talking too fast. Apologies. I like to get as much information to you as I can. So the abilities to see, intuit, hear, and know. We start out with these, but we gradually lose the ability to use them by the time our soul accepts its own sovereignty around the age of 7. Okay, now this is something that's very dear to my heart. Have you ever watched children, young children, clairgustance, thank you. If you've ever watched children, you'll notice that they do a few things different to adults. The first thing is, when they draw people in colour. And they get questioned on this all the time. Why have you drawn Uncle John red? Why is Daddy green? And once they've been questioned 10 or 11 or 12 or 13 or 500 times, they start thinking, oh, there must be something wrong. So when somebody starts telling them to draw people flesh-coloured, they do. But children see auras. Children see auras. So if they're drawing Uncle John red, then either Uncle John's got a problem with his base chakra or Uncle John's a very angry man. Okay, and even if a child only has 4 pen colours, they will still draw people the way they see them. So I just want to point that out again. So children are clairvoyant, they see aurically people's colours, and they draw that way. But it gets knocked out of them by well-meaning, or perhaps the better word here would be ignorant, adults that say, but why did you do that? And the children do it because that's what they see. Another one of my favorite examples is, how many times have you gone to put a child to bed and the child says, I can't go to sleep, there's something behind the door, under the bed, in the closet, wherever. And the parent will just go, shh, no there isn't, go to sleep. The child has picked up an energy or an entity or a spirit or a family member in spirit or whatever, and they have pointed it out to you, and you have poo-pooed the whole thing by saying, no, there isn't. Go to sleep. So after being told that a few times, they start to think, well, I'll just keep my mouth shut. Can't be a good thing. The same thing happens when they have, and here again, another one of the phrases that could disappear from the face of the earth and I'd be thrilled, imaginary friends. You're too old for imaginary friends. But it's not imaginary friends, is it? It could be anything from the divine to angels, to archangels, to ascended masters, family members and spirit guides, energies or entities that belong to the house or the room or the furniture or anything like that. That's right, Jody's popped in with, we don't realize that we are teaching fear. That's exactly right. We don't realize that we are teaching fear. We are knocking out all those good connections to their soul self, their higher self, and we are replacing it with our beliefs. And that's a frightening thought. That's a frightening thought. But all children, every newly minted soul that comes through, newly physical, is firmly attached to their higher self and their soul, and very much in touch with their basic toolkit of clairvoyance, clairsentience, clairaudience, and claircognizance. Now, under the age of 7, it's widely accepted that the sovereignty of a soul is, the parent is responsible, or whoever the carer is. But by the age of 7, children are responsible for themselves. And anyone who's been a parent or closely involved with children will know this. usually earlier than this, usually by the age of 4 or 5, the children will start telling you what they're wearing, where they're going, who they want to spend time with. Because they know. They know who they want their energy around. They know whose energy they want to pick up on. They know who they don't. And we're the ones that try and force the obligations and the should. You know, we should go and visit Auntie so-and-so, so you should play with their children. But if that's not good for you, the children will know that straight away. So this is knocked out of us very, very early on, and a lot of people, not with everybody. Obviously, some people have a very strong connection to their higher self, and that remains. It depends on how many lives they've had, what stage of their development they're at. So not everybody is like this. But for the most part, when I look around me and the people who come to me for advice and help, they are people who have had this connection damaged or scattered or staticked away, and we're trying to get that back. So we then spend our lives learning the lessons that we came here for, and we slowly work our way back to spiritualism and understanding of our gifts. Although, as I said, some never lose their ability, and some get theirs all at once with full knowing. Some are born with it all at once and full knowing. And others discover one piece at a time. Others get them knocked into it. This is both a fortunate and an unfortunate circumstance. I've known people who have had car accidents and brain injuries, and then all of a sudden, once the brain injury has shut down that 90% of the chatter that we spend our lives trying to work over and around, once that's been knocked out, their connection to their higher self just becomes clear and evident to them. And this is why you always hear time after time that the journey is your own and each journey is different, okay? There is no hard and fast rule for this. And this is just my take on things. Feel free to go Google crazy and find out what works for you. But here's the way I teach it. If you've ever had a vivid dream or one that came true, that's a form of premonition. That's the seed of clairvoyance, okay? So if you have a dream and you remember it the next day, that could be as simple or as a message or as complicated as a premonition, but it is a form of clairvoyance. So I want that to sink in with those of you listening for a moment, because I can almost guarantee everybody's put their hand up if I ask, has that ever happened to you? Okay, or if you've ever had a sense of deja vu, that's another word that can disappear. Deja vu, its meaning means seen twice, and I believe that. But the colloquial meaning of it, somebody will say, when they're talking about deja vu, they just say, oh, I've had deja vu, not as in I've seen that twice, but what a weird feeling. And I'm like, no, you've seen it twice. So usually it's something you've seen in a past life or you've seen in a dream, and now you're living it, hence the deja vu, the second seeing. So that's clairvoyance. Now, if everybody hasn't got their hand up now, I'll be very, very surprised. Very surprised indeed. So that is clairvoyance. Clairvoyance. I'm just going to quickly pop into the chat room and see what's going on there. Yeah, so we've been teaching fear. And I'm just going to have a quick look. We've got some pictures coming in, image. Yeah, that's right. Beautiful. See the things that Fellini's popped in with a picture that her daughter has painted. And that's exactly right. They absolutely see people and places in color, and they paint and they describe that way. We're the ones that knock that out of them. We're the ones that do that. So you've all managed to put your hands up talking about clairvoyance. So we'll move on to the next one. Have you ever asked someone to repeat what they said only to find that they didn't say anything? You do that to a friend, you go, what was that? And they go, me? I didn't say anything. Okay, so somebody said something and you heard it. So where do you think that came from? Or if you find you keep hearing the same songs on the radio or repeating in your head. If you hear the same song on the radio, that's a message or a family member or a guide trying to get information to you. What is the name of the song? What are the lyrics of the song? What's the name of the artist? Does it have meaning to you from an old school camp or family get together? Okay, these things are the seed of clear audience, clear hearing. Can everybody put their hand up for one of those two things? Yeah, low, yes. Absolutely. Okay, so that is the seed of clear audience. You all have it. Fantastic. So let's move on to the next one. Put your hand up if you have ever been in an unfamiliar situation, a new job, or a crisis, like an earthquake or a bushfire, and you've just instinctively known what to do. Have you ever been standing in a queue and just felt the need to angle your body away from somebody or take a step back? Or got your hands up? Yeah, that's a seed of clear cognizance, of knowing. You just know what to do, or know that there's a negative energy, or know information about somebody that you couldn't possibly know. Be able to finish someone's sentence, know what they were going to say next, or know when they start talking what the conversation's going to be about. That happens a lot. That's clear cognizance. That's a clear knowing. So all of these can be exercised and developed as if you choose to. Now, I have a lot of people, and once again, no judgment. Everybody's at a different place in their journey. But they ask me the same questions over and over and over and over. They may ask in a different way, but they're asking the same question. And it might come down to a lack of self-worth, or a lack of self-knowledge, or a lack of a desire to take control of one's life. It could be a fear of being in control. It could be any number of things. But they ask me the same questions over and over and over. And it is a little frustrating to me, because if you all have these clear senses and you all have the ability to use them, then it frustrates me a little that people understand that they're there but don't want to develop or connect and use them for themselves. It's fantastic that you can call someone like me or anyone in a healing modality and ask them, you know, who's around me or what should my next decision be and that sort of thing. But sometimes it's not that simple. Sometimes, you know, they are wanting you to connect for yourself. And in order to do that, sometimes that requires a little work. Sometimes that requires you getting off your backside and doing some study, doing some practice, doing some meditation, doing some exercises that develop this. So it's about taking ownership of some of these things for yourself. You know, the only difference between someone like me who can do healings or readings or whatever and someone who doesn't, the only difference between us is that I had the desire to develop it. So there is no blockage. There is no block at all to anybody learning or developing any of this. Money is no object. You can get this information online. Being online is no object. You can get this information from people in your town or who live just up the road. You are not a blockage. You have access and ability to all of these clear senses. It's not something that you don't have. You know, there is really nothing stopping you if you decide you want to. And I mean, even fear, okay, that's a huge one. People come and I'm afraid. And I always say be fascinated, not fearful. But fear is a choice. So really, that's not blocking you either. There is nothing, absolutely nothing blocking you. Fellini's popped in with, at one point it screams at you, and that's when you have no choice. And it's a blessing. That's exactly right. Some people, it comes across very, very quickly. Mine came about through some really, really unfortunate life circumstances. Spirit had gone, right, that's enough mucking around. You're not doing what you should be doing. This is what you're supposed to be doing. But they didn't come at me anywhere near that obvious. It wasn't that obvious at all. What they did was slam a whole heap of doors in my face. I was, what's the word I'm looking for? Assholed. Am I allowed to say that? I was assholed out of two jobs. I hadn't done anything wrong. I was very, very good at what I do and what I did, and I'm like that with every job that I do. It was personality issues and a bit of backstabbing and those sorts of things. So the employment door was shut in my face. The relationship door was shut in my face. My partner and I had had a wonderful 10 or 11 years together, and then due to circumstances in his life, he returned to something he'd done years earlier, which is being an addict. And I tried to deal with that for as long as I can. We tried to deal with it for as long as we can. It was about 6 or 7 years like that. But that was a lesson too. So the relationship door was slammed in my face. Those situations caused the finance door to be slammed in my face. My father passed away, so the rocks and the things that I had relied on in my life to help me through troubled times had been removed. So those doors were slammed in my face. Spirit was saying, these are not the right ways for you to go. Turn around. So I turned around. And I'm like, what am I looking at here? And there was a big blank nothing. And that's when I learned that sometimes you have to look through the darkness and see what's sitting there. You know, it's very easy to look at that black and go, there's nothing for me. But it is possible to look through that and see what sits behind that veil, beyond that veil. Flowers going, that happened to me, makes sense. Yeah, that's right. You know, not everybody comes to it in a pleasant and joyful manner. But the Jewish family believe that there's no such thing as a negative circumstance. I'm not sure on the full sense around the tradition, but their basic understanding is, let's say, for example, you have an accident and break your leg and you're off work for 6 weeks. And during that time, you either spend a bit of time unpaid or you lose your job because of it. They believe that circumstance is teaching you that that job or that income was not right or appropriate for you, and you need to sit down and do whatever it is you want to do, go off on that other direction or look for that other job. Or so they believe there's no such thing as a negative circumstance. And through many circumstances that have happened to me over a long period of time now, probably 6 years, I'm coming to understand that there is no such thing as a negative circumstance. You know, even the things that have happened this year, like my brother passing away, you would think would be very negative. First thing that happened there is it made me understand that some people who I thought I could count on turned out to be fake pillars of strength. Is that what I want to say? And people who I had prior to that considered merely acquaintances showed that they were fabulous, wonderful people. So while it may appear to be a very negative circumstance, there were some very good things that came out of that. Part of that was knowing who to spend time with at Christmas, which we were talking about before. You know, where should my energies be? Where are they best spent for the highest good of myself? And what would make me happiest? You know, those are things that I hadn't thought about prior to that. It was very much about shoulds and obligations. And since my brother passed, it's been very much about where do I want to be? What do I want to do? So these things that appear to be negative influences can sometimes be the most positive thing that can happen. And it's about, I'm not about, you know, airy-fairy, you need to develop yourself spiritually and life is always wonderful. You know, we're here for a physical experience, and some of those pains and those problems and those stressors are things that we are supposed to experience. They're to help us grow. They're to help us help others. They're to push you. Fellini's saying here, blessings in disguise. Often a cataclysm brings forth the path you need to be on. That's right. That's exactly right. You know, they are for showing you the light. If you haven't been able to find that lighthouse yourself, these things are trying to point you in the right direction. So rather than be fearful of suddenly seeing a full floating apparition or hearing the voice of your great-great-grandfather who's long since gone, or thinking that, oh my God, this is the worst thing that's ever happened in my life, look at it and go, what is it teaching me? Where have I been going wrong? There's no such thing as wrong. Everything's a learning, but where have I been putting my energies when they could be better put somewhere else? Where have I been sort of wandering off the path of happiness and a fantastic life And how do I get back on that? So Flower's going, I didn't know how I did that. That's right. You know, and sometimes, as I said earlier, it comes to people quickly. Sometimes they can have some major physical or emotional trauma. If someone close to you commits suicide, or you end up in a horrific car accident, or things like that, you can suddenly find very quickly that what is clear and true and love and light shows itself very, very clearly, and everything that is not of the light equally shows itself very clearly. So if you pay attention, you can find that the way is pointed forward quite clearly. And this is a question that people ask me a lot. What is my next move? I don't know what to do. And I often wish that if they just sit down and have a look at this big cataclysmic event, what's the message in that? The message is that this is not the right way for you. They're giving you an opportunity for a bit of a clean slate, as it were, to go, right, well, that wasn't the right thing for me. What's in front of me now? And that's not always easy and clear either. But sometimes your guides are there to do just exactly that. Think about the name. They're there to guide. They're not there to tell you what to do every step of every day. They're there to point you in the right direction. So maybe they had something to do with this cataclysmic event, but the next part is up to you. So I'm going to leave you thinking about that for a second while we take a short break. Colin's popped in, the lovely Colin, to say it's time just flies. I get so caught up in this stuff. We've done an hour and a half already. Where does it go? You're listening live on Sock Radio to Kim Malhop. Sounds like spirit, sound advice for spiritual souls. I am thrilled and honored to be able to contact you this way and to be able to converse and pass on any information I may have and hopefully be of help to you at some stage. And I'll be back just after this short break to take you through to what is midday or noon here in New Zealand, depending on where you are. Of course, that won't be the case for you. But we'll be back after this short break. We'll see you soon.
We will be back shortly with Kim on Sounds Like Spirit. Spiritualistsonline.com. Online since 2002, teaching all aspects of personal and spiritual development. Free to all with audio video chat rooms, members forums, and Sock Radio live shows on site. The Spiritualist Online Network and Lyceum, a global oasis for spiritual awareness, development, attainment, imparting knowledge, thoughts, ideas to inspire. One site, linking a whole network of spiritually informative, educational, and interactive services, encompassing every faith, path, walk, religion as one. Premium membership on spiritualistsonline.com. Join our teaching lyceum, classes and courses to certificate and diploma levels. It's an option, not an obligation. Still only £30 per year for unlimited seminars, guest sessions, members' moments, voice members included on radio chats and TV shows, full certificate courses and qualifications, members' promotions of sites, books and services, discounts on SOC services, one-on-one teaching, private classes, members-only Facebook. Upgrade your membership today. Joint family group options. See spiritualistsonline.com. Spirit Talk with Julie. Spirits medium Julie Simpson and guests delve into the world of spirit, the faith and the way of life, renewing the movement that brought two worlds together and ancient spiritual beliefs to the forefront of society, proving once and for all there is nothing to fear in talking to spirit. Live in the Sock Radio chat room on spiritualistsonline.com, or simply listen in at tunein.com and search for Sock Radio. Spirit Weavers with Jodie White Wolf Morrison, a weekly 1 hour radio show, Thursdays 8 p.m. UK time, featuring those who are dedicated to living their spirituality and exploring how that is woven into their everyday lives through their work, practices and beliefs. Various SOC members from Spiritualist Online Network and Lyceum sharing their abilities, knowledge and more. Dates and times will vary. live in the SOC Radio chat room on spiritualistonline.com, or simply listen in at tunein.com and search for SOC Radio. The Circle of Mediums Radio Show. 6 mediums, healers, psychics, tarot, astrologers, spiritual workers every week, sharing spirit messages, development techniques, guidance, and much more. Live in the SOC Radio chat room on spiritualistonline.com, or simply listen in at tunein.com. Search SOC Radio. Would you like to contribute readings, thoughts, teachings, and time to this 2-hour show? Get in touch at socradioshows@gmail.com. Jenny Lee brings you spiritual insights, covering various topics from remote viewing to her upcoming book launch. Check it all out on our schedule live in the SOC Radio chat room on spiritualistonline.com, or simply listen in at tunein.com and search for SOC Radio. Welcome back to Sounds Like Spirit, sound advice for spiritual souls.
Go.
Welcome. You are live on SOC Radio, listening to me, Kim Melhop, Sounds Like Spirit, the sound advice for spiritual souls. We talk about anything and everything. The first hour today, need more Diet Coke. No, you don't. You never heard that from me. Water. You need more water. That's what you need. We talked about how to stress less about Christmas and other big occasions. Brought that right back down to how to stress less about some of the things that you do every day. Get rid of some of the shoulds and the obligations in your life and start doing a few more of the things that make you happy and develop you and make you feel better about yourself and enjoy your life more. And the second half of the show, we've been talking about the spiritual gifts of clairaudience, claircognizance, clairsentience, and clairvoyance, how everybody has them, and we've given examples of that. And I love examples. We did talk about no judgment, though. I've just popped back to my Facebook support group, and Tony Reed, she's a lovely lady. I often read her posts. She is a medium, specializes in tarot and cards, and she's got here great info. She agrees we all have the potential to develop our psychic and healing abilities, but some unfortunately never try to understand them or develop them. And that's exactly what I said earlier. No judgment. Everyone's at a different stage in their journey, and this lifetime may not be about that for them. But, you know, maybe one day. And if you're aware, then that's great. And I've got a wee story here from one of the other ladies. She said the example that I gave for clairaudience has definitely happened. And she was at a local pub with her manager after work for a drink, and she was taking me home that night and had said to the others that we should go after we'd finished our drinks. And as she was sipping her drink, she kept hearing her say, "Come on, quickly, I want to go now. Come on, quickly, I want to go now." So she was looking at it when she was hearing a voice, but she didn't open her mouth at all. So never mind that we were in a noisy bar and she was 4 seats away. She wouldn't have heard her anyway. So, you know, in those sorts of instances that absolutely your clear senses are up and firing on all cylinders. So it is a question of once you, as I said, there was no one in the chat room today that couldn't have put their hand up for one of those examples. So once you all understand that you have all of these gifts, and I use the term loosely because how can it be a gift if everybody has it? If you understand that they have it, then there's no reason why you can't be accessing it and accessing your higher self and accessing the information and the joy that you get from this sort of connection. Jodie's talking about a book launch. Have I missed something in there, sweet? Sorry. I'm reading in the chat room and talking to you at the same time, and I've obviously missed something. So clear senses, everybody has them. Everyone can develop them. It is a choice. And it's a gift. That's why they call it the present. That's right. Absolutely. I think Oogwe off Kung Fu Panda says that. So yesterday is history. Tomorrow is a mystery. And today is a gift. That's why they call it the present. And that's exactly right. You can't do anything about yesterday. Yesterday is well and truly gone. The past is all about regret. If you're living in the past or reliving things from your past, you're living in anger and you're living in regret. And neither of those are useful, and it doesn't help you to move forward. And if you're living in the future, you tend to be living in envy because you're thinking about all the things that you'll do when you have this, or what will happen when you achieve that. So you need to try and pay a wee bit more attention to what's happening around you right now. Tracy's just popped into the chat room with, I know this may be a bit off topic, but do you find when during a retrograde our senses increase? Yeah, for some people they do. Not for everyone, Tracy. Sometimes I wonder if that's a bit of a cosmic joke, because for those of you who do or don't know, retrograde is when planets or moons appear to be moving backwards in their orbit. They're not moving backwards. It's just the position they're sitting in relation to Earth and how we can see them physically makes them appear to be moving backwards, but they're not moving backwards. How that works energetically, particularly with Mercury in retrograde, is that it tends to affect electronics and things that work around you electronically. So we're talking phones and microphones and computers and Facebook programs and all those sorts of things tend to be very screwy during retrograde. And I wonder if that's the cosmic joke there, Tracy, is that because those things crap out, we have to rely on our senses more. So do our senses actually increase, or are we just paying more attention to them when some of the things in our physical world tap out of our sphere of influence a wee bit? But Jody thinks that's funny. Absolutely. But yes, with some people, electricity, that's right, electricity, Jody. With some people, their senses do increase because planetary orbits and moon's positions have a huge influence on gravitational pull. Gravitational pull has a huge influence on anything that's water-based, like lakes and rivers and oceans. And of course, that would include us. We are hugely water-based creatures. So of course it's going to have an effect on us, just like full moons have an effect on our ability. Those of you that are clairvoyant will notice you have a lot of weird and wonderful, amazing dreams during full moons, usually a couple of days either side. So for a week, you might find yourself having weird dreams and strange premonitions and things like that. So yeah, absolutely a great question. Yes, we do get an increase in senses during retrograde. But as I said, I do think sometimes it's a great cosmic joke, because a lot of the electronic technology that we rely on doesn't exactly work particularly well during any form of retrograde. For those of you that are interested, the best way of balancing out a retrograde to neutralize its power over you is forward momentum using wheels upon the Earth's surface. That's lovely and technical, but what it means is get on your bike, Mike. What it means is jump on a bicycle. Self-propelled motion via cyclical wheels attached to Earth is the way to Earth and ground yourself so that the retrogrades don't affect you so much. I am guessing a skateboard would work, as would probably roller skates. A car won't do it, people, because a car is not self-propelled. It must be self-propelled. And I'm sure there are other things you can do during retrograde to help minimize the effects that it can have on you. But one of the best I find is bicycling. So for those of you who have never done that before, feel free to give that a go during retrograde and see how it works for you. Tracy's just saying she's found her senses are stronger. HSP, highly sensitive person. Well, of course you are, darling. Of course you are a highly sensitive person. And highly sensitive people will pick up these changes in electrical impulse and gravity and water pull and all those sort of things. Very much so. Some people who are highly sensitive don't. And I think that has a lot to do with protections and guides and stuff like that. It's almost like they're saying, we don't need you to deal with this right now. You've got other things to deal with. But for others of us, they're saying, we need you to understand the effects these things have on you so they will allow you to feel them. And Jody's going, which can be challenging, as it means you're also picking up more from others and merging that with what's within you. That's right. Yep. Yeah, so bicycling, for those of you that are able, or using a scooter would work, roller skates, roller blades, skateboards, any of those things would work. So yeah, on your bike, Mike, that's the way to do it. Get out and balance that out. So if you find you're having trouble with it, Tracy, I would suggest giving that a wee go. I'm sure if you Google, you'll find a ton of things that will come up on what you can use to help get you through retrograde. But yeah, absolutely. Mercury is the one that comes around the most often and causes the most problems. So that's the one you need to be aware of. And they happen frequently. So Jody's going, even doing it not physically but through intent and inner vision. Yeah, I haven't tried it, but it could work. Never knock it till you tried it. It's one of my favorite sayings. Don't knock it till you've tried it. My other favorite saying is, I'll do anything once, twice if I like it. So finding out what works for you during these times and what doesn't can absolutely be hugely beneficial to you, because if you know retrograde or a full moon or a new moon or things like that are coming up, it can give you more of an idea of what to expect or why things are functioning the way they do. The funny thing to note, though, Tracy, is that if you are getting stronger senses during particular times, then you know that you can access stronger senses, and why not try accessing those all the time? Food for thought there. Food for thought there. Absolutely. All right. So today we've covered stressing less over big occasions and Christmas and things like that. We've discussed clear senses and how everybody has them. I know I've done that before, but it just bears repeating, because the questions I get asked are often around people saying, oh, can I develop them? I don't have the gift, or I do have this gift of clear whatever. But they're only listing sort of one thing. And it just amazes me that people seem to think that they can have part of one of these gifts in one wee area of their life, but nothing else. I'm just going to try a wee trick here and see if you can hear this. It may or may not. Can you all hear that? No. Right, my apologies, my lovelies. I just wanted to play a wee bit of a thing called Jim Wilson's God's Chorus of Crickets. Now, if you get a chance to have a look at it, how do I find a link for that? Not sure how I find a link for that. It is on my page on Monday under Sounds Like Spirit. Every Monday I do something that has something to do with clear audience or sound. And what I put up this week was Jim Wilson's God's Chorus of Crickets. Now, what it is this is just a wee snippet for you at the end of the show here. What it's the chorus of crickets chirping. Now, it's been slowed way down, and when you slow it down, crickets have a much shorter lifespan than ours, and if you slow the sound of their the noise that they make down to the speed it would be played at if their lifespan was as long as ours, so make it relevant to the way and the speed at which we speak, it sounds like an angel's choir. Sparkling and celestial, full of harmony and bass parts. You wouldn't believe it. It's like a sweeping chorus of heaven, and it's just slowed down. They don't manipulate this at all. So what Jim Wilson's done is he's taken the sound of crickets chirping and played it, and then over top of that, he's played a track of what they sound like slowed down. And he makes a note that there's something to be said for slowing down the world. But if you get a chance, please find that and have a look at it. Jim Wilson's chorus, God's Chorus of Crickets. Okay, so they've managed to put these two tracks together. So on top, they've got the sound of the crickets playing slowed down, and it sounds like a choir. It really does. And in the background of that, you can hear the crickets chirping at normal speed. It's a fantastic recording. It's about an hour long, but you could listen for 20 seconds or a minute. You get the idea of what we're talking about here. And I'd like you to all have a wee listen. Fellini's popped through there and says, yeah, it sounds like a Christmas cantique or angelic. And it is incredible. It is fantastic. And this is the sounds of nature. And you listen to crickets and you think, oh, that's vaguely annoying. but they're pleasant. I like them. I wouldn't want them in trees outside my bedroom all day, every day. But it's pleasant to walk through the park and listen to them or in the back of the room. So Fellini's having a listen now. You're listening now. That's exciting. Tracy's put the link up. Thank you so much. Just went there. Oh, my God, it's amazing. That is right. So do you see what I'm saying about what we do and don't hear in our world and what we do and don't pick up with our clear senses? There's so much stuff around us on a daily basis, and we just blithely ignore most of it. And when you listen to something like this, you truly understand how great this physical world is, how fantastic it is, how privileged we are to be a wee part of it, even the tiniest little part of it. And you listen to something like the crickets, and I haven't got a link to it on hand, and I can't remember the name. And I know, Tracy, you're awesome at picking up links and things like that. But there is some people who have recorded plants. I don't know how to say it. They have attached little diodes that don't hurt the plants, I assure you. They don't hurt the plants or hurt the trees. And they transferred it through a program that transfers the sound back to binary code, which is what a computer operates on. And then the computer puts that back out in sound as we understand it. And you listen to these plants and these trees, and they're singing. They're making beautiful music. It's a bit wind chimey. If you've ever heard wind chimes sort of chiming pleasantly in the wind, it's a bit like that. And there's a huge difference between a small pot plant and a 300-year-old tree. And the sounds that they put out is the most amazing thing. Now, I know you may or may not clairaudiently be able to hear a tree if you go and sit and meditate at the base of it, but I can almost guarantee you will energetically feel it, the energy that comes off a tree of that size. You know, it is just amazing. And I just want you all to experience that this week. I know we're running out of time, but if you do get a chance to listen to that God's Chorus, Jim Wilson's Crickets, or get a chance to look up and listen to the trees or the plants singing. Jodie's going, she thinks she's heard that. If she finds the link, she'll post it in the Facebook members group. That'll be fantastic. Or on my personal timeline, or on the Sounds Like Spirit post about the crickets, anywhere like that. Jodie, would be fantastic if you find it. I might do it myself if I find it. I've actually got my daughter and her partner working on getting some sound out of plants here to see if we could do it, because it fascinates me, and I think it would be a beautiful backdrop for meditations and things like that. So usually if you hear a sound that you find unpleasant, let's say, for example, if you listen to the crickets and you find it horrendously unpleasant, then you've probably got a blockage in one of your chakras. Because we're designed to hear and see and feel and know all these things around us. And if something particularly agitates us, then we need a wee bit more development, and we need to open something. So it's worth thinking about the sounds that agitate you. What is it teaching you? Day-to-day sounds that agitate you are teaching you to remove yourself from that energy. You know, I think we've discussed this when we did the lead into the Clear Senses course. We talked about, if you walk into a restaurant and hear a metal chair scraping on a concrete floor, the message is, get out. There's another restaurant up the road or another cafe. Go somewhere else. Either something negative's happening in that place, and it may just be negative sounds, or it may be negative energy, or it may be something awful like the chef not washing his hands and people are going to get some nasty wee diseases. Or it could be something positive, like there's a friend waiting for you in the next cafe, or a new person to meet, or any number of those sorts of things. I've just had someone come in my room. Isn't that fabulous? The door's opened all by itself and someone has walked in. So hi. We'll pick up on whoever that is shortly. But they've come in to say hello, which is fabulous. I love it when that happens. And so Jodie's going, like the neighbor's dog's barking. Yeah, I've had a fantastic and interesting experience with a neighbor's dog barking. They locked him outside. He's relatively new to them. And they locked him outside down their back fence line, which is backs onto my driveway, which is right next to the bedrooms on this side of my house. And I decided to telepathically, for want of a better phrase, talk to the dog and tell him to calm down. It's all right that I'm here, that they're there. They're just on the other side of the wall. And it worked. So, Jody, if you've got an issue with the neighbor's dogs barking, I'd like you to try communicating with them. Animals quite often think in pictures. So if you can send him a picture, if you listen closely, you can usually find out why a dog's barking. They're bored, they're lonely, they feel like they've been ostracized from the family. They very much live in the now, and if the now is lonely and quiet and boring, they'll certainly be kicking up a bit of a stink. They could be cold, they could be hungry, they could be needing a walk, they could be needing all sorts of things. So you can try and intuit, try and connect with the dog energetically and see what their problem is. And once you know what their problem is, you can try and send them a picture of what it is they would like. So company or warmth, or to know that they're not alone, or to know to keep calm, it's just time for bed, or whatever it is you want to talk to them about. Try and send them those messages via a picture, or those messages via the feeling. Try and feel it yourself and send that feeling through to them. And I know people might laugh at this. I'm not an animal communicator. I can communicate with animals, and I have done. I went dolphin sighting here in Akaroa, and I went dolphin sighting in Bali in September this year, which is a fantastic experience. And they're all going, you know, well, there's a minimal chance of seeing dolphin. And I sat there and I got a few of my friends on it. Does it really work? Absolutely, it does. Absolutely. And the strength of your faith and your energy has a lot to do with it, but absolutely it works. And I feel sorry for the dog. I mean, dogs don't bark for fun. I've never known a dog to bark for fun. They do it because they're miserable. And if you can find out the reason that they're miserable, then even if it's not your dog and you can't physically change their circumstances, you can energetically and vibrationally change their circumstances. Those of you who have ever done distance healing or distance Reiki, any of those sorts of things, you know that you can make somebody feel better by sending them positive thoughts. You know that you can make them feel warmer by sending them thoughts of warmth and sun and warm blankets. You can make them feel like they've been wrapped in a blanket. So yeah, absolutely, it does work. I would love you to give this a go, Jody, and get back to me. It won't always work straight away or the first time. Sometimes it's going to take you a bit of practice to tune in. As I said, I'm not an animal communicator, but I have communicated with animals on various occasions. I have done readings for people when their horse or their dog or their cats passed away. I've had people tell me that it's a vastly different vibration or energy to dealing with human spirit, and I haven't actually found it to be so. And you can pick up, you know, I've done readings on people and I've picked up an energy around them, and I've explained it in detail, and they've said to me, oh, that's my ex-partner, or that's my mother in England, or that's my, so you can pick up energy and connection from people that and entities and animals that are still living just as easily as you can as those that have passed. You don't always know that that's what you're doing until whoever you're dealing with confirms that for you. But as I said, I haven't noticed the energies or the vibrations of an animal to be vastly different to pick up than those of human or spirit of any other kind. When you are healing somebody, and I think, Jody, you do a wee bit of healing, do you? When you're doing healing for somebody, either right next to them or via distance, you send those thoughts of calm or those thoughts of positive energy or light or whatever it is that you use through to those people. So why not do that for the poor dog? As I said, you know, it annoys me, and I've often been to neighbors and said, look, your dog's upset. Can you, you know, it's not necessarily about retraining the dog. Sometimes it's about retraining the damn owners. But yeah, they don't bark for fun. They bark because they're trying to tell you something. So if you can get hold of them and pass some of that information or warmth or companionship or whatever it is that they're after onto them, then absolutely you can help them out And of course, it makes life far more pleasant for you as well, obviously. You know, I'd love to think we'd all do these things for completely altruistic reasons, but sometimes it's just to improve our current circumstances, and there's nothing wrong with that either. You know, if you don't sleep well, you're not going to do so well the next day. So it's not selfish to want to quiet the barking dog next to you. But as I said, I have called animals to me via you know, the dolphins out at sea, and a lot of people call animals to them energetically. You've ever had friends walk into your house and your pets just straight away go up to them and start rubbing around their legs and wanting their attention or sniffing their crotch? And they go into it straight away. It was because the energetic vibration and frequency, the call sign, if you like, that these people are putting out is very warm and friendly and open and inviting and positive, and the animals go, yep, I want to get me some of that. I love that. So they just go straight over to it because they want to do what makes them feel good. Animals aren't stupid. They're far smarter than humans when it comes to that sort of thing. It takes us a long time to see who is positive for our energy and who is negative, but your pets will see it straight away, absolutely straight away. Tracy's going, sometimes I get images during a healing, so after the healing I pass on the image I saw. Absolutely. So you understand how these things are interchangeable. I have a friend who is a Reiki master, and I said to her if she'd like to help me out on my free reading day on my sites on Sound Like Spirit. She goes, well, I'm not a reader. And I said, but you're a healer. And she said, yes. And I said, but you draw on universal energy. So why are you not using that same connection for communication rather than just healing? If you are a healer, you can be a reader. If you are a reader, you can be a healer. It's a choice. If you're happy doing what you're doing and you don't want to do anything else, that's fine. But, you know, no judgment at all. But if you are capable of being a healer, then you are capable of being a reader. And if you are a reader, then you are capable of being a healer. It's just a question of accessing the communication or the energy or the whatever it is you're not currently working with. They're just tools of the trade. And if you work with people who have passed, you can equally work with people who are living. And if you currently only work with people who are living for healings and things like that, then you can equally work with people who have passed. So when I was talking before earlier about if you understand that you've got some of these gifts from these day-to-day physical experiences, then you've got to understand that you've got them all. What have we got here from Tracy? It's funny also, since our dog got a haircut, he's got a lot of energy. Now, we talked about that a couple of weeks ago, didn't we? Haircuts and what is a natural length for your hair and how you can use it to ensure it. And oh, good Lord, that's heading off into yet another topic. And it is already, welcome Buster, lovely Buster the dog's visiting us there. It is already after 12 o'clock. So I am sorry, guys, but I do need to shut the show down for the day. Everybody said to me on numerous occasions, what on earth are you going to talk about for 2 hours? And I'm like, are you kidding? It could be 4 hours or 6 hours or 8 hours. We'd still find plenty to fill in the time. So, yes, a quick recap on today. Please make your life less stressful. If you don't like doing dishes every single day and you don't have to because you're not running out of dishes, then don't do them every day. If you don't like mowing the lawns, get someone else to mow them for you. No money, no problem. Swap something. What can you do that they can't? Okay, so you've got a friend who's, let's say, an energy healer. She needs her lawn mowed, but she can't do it for whatever reason or doesn't want to do it. Then you mow her lawn, she gives you a healing. Excellent. I'm all for the barter system. Make your life easier. Stress less. Find your family very stressful at Christmas. Don't spend time with them. Spend time with the people who build you up, who love you, who make you feel good about yourself, and include them in another way. A Skype chat, a phone call, a present sent, whatever. But don't stress yourself over those things. Christmas decorations stressing you out. Do something a little simpler this year. You know, I love a tree. I absolutely adore the smell of it. I often leave the door shut in my lounge where the tree is, just so that I can walk in a couple of times a day and smell that wonderful smell of pine. But if you don't like that, make a Christmas tree out of lights in the shape of a Christmas tree on your wall, you know, or in the way of hanging Christmas baubles in the shape of a Christmas tree. They don't take much effort, time, energy, money. They're easy to do, easy to remove, you know. So if things are stressing you in the way that you've always done them traditionally or the way other people expect you to do them, then it's time to get rid of those holiday expectations and do what makes you happy. We've talked about clear senses. You've got all of them. Seriously, please believe me. If you need confirmation on this, contact me. You can contact me personally, Kim Melhop at Facebook. You can contact me at facebook.com/soundslikespirit, either the group, which I do for daily support, or the page, which has information on free angel answers or upcoming expos or things that spiritual people might like to know about. I advertise the radio show there. You know, all this stuff is free. If you've got questions or you need information or you want to know how to get over a hurdle, this place is awesome. Come to the SOC Radio Live chat rooms. Talk to people, visit other shows, get into it. Tracy's saying when she mows the lawn, she also does part of the neighbor's lawn and he gives me $5 each time. Fantastic. Yes, Buster the dog is a cutie. The dog's Christmas present was a haircut. So that's a quick recap on what we've talked about today. And I know we've gone well over time. I apologize to our lovely producer, Colin, because we're probably holding him up. So I'd like to thank you all so much for your company today. I'd like to thank those of you who are tuning in online or on the radio stations around the world at tunein.com. I'd like to thank you all so much for listening. I am truly honored and blessed to have you here. It fascinates me endlessly that we can do this. It thrills me no end that you all jump in and help out. And it just excites me that groups of like-minded people can get together like this and improve the lives of themselves and the lives of others. So I hope that even via some little thing, we've done that today, even if it's only via company, at the very least, at the most, information that you didn't have before. And so excited to have friended you all here on in the SOC chat room, and I know some of you have friended me personally online, and it thrills me endlessly that we can do that. Thank you so much for your company, guys. I will log off here. I'll stay in the chat room for another couple of minutes if you've got anything you'd like to say, but I'll let all the lovely people listening in go. Thank lovely Colin, producer, for producing the show today, and we'll see you all back here next Wednesday for me, whatever the time zone is for you, 10 till 12 Wednesday. We'll see you next week. Cheers.
You have been listening to Kim Melhop and Sounds Like Spirits. See you next time. Thanks for joining SOC Radio.